Okay, if we could move swiftly to please the next item of business. And as I say, the next item of business is portfolio is Rural Affairs and Islands. And I remind members that questions 3 and 7 are grouped together and that therefore I will take supplementaries on these questions after both of them have been answered. Otherwise, if a member wishes to request a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button or indicate so in the chat function by entering the letter R during the relevant question. I call question number 1, Claire Baker.
To ask the Scottish Government how it is ensuring that keepers of birds and poultry and the general public are informed and able to respond to cases of the avian influenza virus.
Cabinet Secretary Mary Goujon.
The Scottish Government, through its operational partners, have written to all known poultry keepers in the avian influenza protection and surveillance zone in Angus, informing them of the mandatory biosecurity controls in place and where to get help. Scottish Government meets regularly with key poultry industry stakeholders to discuss the avian influenza situation, and keepers of poultry or other captive birds, as well as members of the public, are routinely informed of current risk levels, disease outbreak information, disease prevention guidance and introduction of mandatory heightened biosecurity measures through social media, SMS messages, news releases and updates to its website.
Claire Baker.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. As she said, there have been cases in Angus and within my Mid Scotland and Fife region, and that the UK is currently an avian influenza prevention zone, meaning strict biosecurity measures are in place. Across Britain, over 1 million households now keep chickens, but registration is only a legal requirement for keepers of larger flocks. How confident is the Cabinet Secretary that those with smaller numbers of birds are keeping up to date with their responsibilities, including self-assessment in relation to the prevention zone status? And what is the Scottish Government doing to ensure this is the case?
Cabinet Secretary.
I completely accept the member's point there and the concern that she raises about other keepers. And I would say that that's where our communications are obviously vital in that regard. In relation to the risk of the incursion of avian influenza from migratory birds across the globe, that's continually assessed. And it was the recent reports of that that triggered the campaign messaging by Scottish Government to really try and encourage the preparedness ahead of the anticipated outbreak season. And as I said in my initial response, you know, the Scottish Government promote preventative messaging using our social media channels, news releases and other media, utilising these to specifically reach out to our rural audiences where much of the livestock are kept. Now, there are challenges there in trying to reach the smaller backyard keepers of less than 50 birds, but we are working hard to ensure that our communications reach them. So I really want to give the member and others across the chamber assurance in that regard.
Supplementary, Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given that this current outbreak of avian influenza is currently affecting other UK nations, with cases recently confirmed in England and Wales, can the Cabinet Secretary outline what engagement the Scottish Government has had with the Department of Environment, Food and Rural Affairs regarding this matter?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm happy to, because the Scottish Government meets daily at a range of meetings with DEFRA, with the Welsh Government and with DERA to take stock of current outbreaks and what the ongoing actions are that are being taken to try and control the disease. And we also meet daily with operational partners and key stakeholders to keep apprised of the current situation and to share that information on actions that are being taken to, first of all, control the disease at infected premises, the surrounded area and the tracing and surveillance activity that's required to really try and prevent the spread of disease too. Now, the most recent assessment of the current risk for wild birds, poultry and other captive birds from highly pathogenic avian influenza in the UK and Europe was published on the 10th of November, and work is underway to update this with the most recent findings, and the Chief Veterinary Officers of the UK will meet to discuss the findings of the assessment and whether further preventative actions need to be taken.
Question number 2, Douglas Lumsden.
To ask the Scottish Government how it's supporting the rural economy in the North East.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government provides significant support to the rural economy in the North East through its £125 million contribution towards the Aberdeen City Region deal and a further £254 million investment alongside the City deal to support road, rail, housing and digital projects across the region. And working with partners, communities and other stakeholders, an investment in innovation, digital connectivity and infrastructure will help to diversify the regional economy, create new jobs and aid in the transition to an net zero economy. And that includes work that's being led by Scottish Enterprise, delivering a number of transformational projects in the North East. And within the Aberdeen City Region deal and co-created with industry, the £21 million seed pod project will provide support to help the region become a leader in low carbon food production and environmental sustainability.
Douglas Lumsden.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. A non-delivery of the R100 broadband programme in the North East and rural Scotland is seriously hindering businesses, communities and the delivery of NHS care while increasing rural inequalities. It recently emerged in the Press and Journal that the rollout had slipped again to the end of 2026-27 financial year. How is this government going to compensate our rural communities for the six-year broadband delay that they have caused?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm sorry, but I simply refuse to accept that assertion that's been made by the member when this is a reserved area and the Scottish Government has gone above and beyond to pay for the rollout of this infrastructure, a job that should have been done and the investment that should have been made by the UK Government. So I'm afraid I don't recognise that at all.
Supplementary, Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Seed potato merchants in my constituency have been in touch with me to ask for my support to their letter to the Prime Minister as they face exclusion from exporting to EU markets in Northern Ireland as a result of the Brexit deal. My constituent says there's been no attempt by the UK Government to protect them and they've instead allowed EU imports to England, Wales and Northern Ireland of seed potatoes. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what communication the Scottish Government has had with their UK Government counterparts on this and how they are assisting the seed potato sector so vital to the North East rural economy?
Cabinet Secretary.
The member is absolutely right. This is a really vital industry, particularly in the areas that we both represent and across the northeast of Scotland. And the Scottish Government absolutely share the concerns that have been raised by the seed potato industry. Now, the Scottish seed and ware potato industry is a vital part of our successful rural economy, and as I've already said, particularly in the northeast of Scotland. And I think, regrettably, it's another example of where a Scottish industry is being disproportionately impacted by EU exit. And it's also an example of where the UK government's failure to secure, through negotiations with the EU, an outcome which could have protected this key Scottish industry as far as possible from the impacts of EU exit. Now, finding a resolution to this is an absolute priority for the Scottish government. And we've raised concerns with the UK government from the outset of this on the serious impact of losing access to the EU and Northern Ireland market on the seed potato sector. And that includes through the interministerial groups, the regular meetings that we have there, but as well as engaging regularly with the UK government and our counterparts and with seed potato representatives. Now, the Scottish Government has written to the DEFRA Secretary of State to request an urgent update on progress with the UK equivalence application with EU for our seed potatoes, as well as to seek assurance that Scottish seed potato producers will not be placed at a commercial disadvantage over suppliers from the EU in supplying seed to ware potato growers in England while we do not have that reciprocal trade with the EU.
Question number three, Cocab Stewart, who is joining us remotely.
To ask the Scottish Government, in relation to the impact on the food and drink supply chain, what its response is to a recent survey of 1,000 UK businesses by Gallagher, which reportedly found that many businesses have been affected by a shortage of staff because of the COVID-19 pandemic and the impact of Brexit regulations.
Cabinet Secretary.
Just to say that I am aware of that report that was published by Gallagher, and although much of the detail covers the retail sector, I think its findings nonetheless provide further evidence of just the extraordinary recklessness of this hard Brexit, which takes us out of the EU, the single market and the customs union as COVID-19 continues to ravage our society and our economy.
Cocab Stewart.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. In the light of this research, does she share my view that the pursuit of this hard Brexit forced upon Scotland at the height of an unprecedented public health crisis amounts to nothing less than an act of governmental vandalism, which put ideology ahead of the needs of our economy?
Cabinet Secretary.
I absolutely agree with that, and I think, you know, more importantly, I think industry would agree with that as well. And Scotland Food and Drink, James Withers, the chief executive, had said that Brexit has been an enormous shock to the labour market, and a Brexit implemented in the middle of a pandemic when supply chains were already straining. And there's no doubt that the harm that's been caused by Brexit on Scotland's economy, and especially the rural parts of it for which I have responsibility, is going to be long-lasting. And the most recent research suggesting that many exporters are thinking about relocating to mainland Europe is just really depressing, if not entirely unexpected, given that our exporters have been facing barriers to trade now for nearly a year, which has created a completely unlevel playing field with importers. Now, we continue to do all that we can within the powers and resources that we have to support our businesses and exporters, but I think the solution to this is increasingly clear: for Scotland to vote for independence and to rejoin the EU.
Question number 7, Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what recent engagement it has had with the Secretary of State for the Environment, Food and Rural Affairs regarding reports of labour and skills shortages in the food and drink industry and supply chain.
Cabinet Secretary.
I have written to the UK Government a number of times, and most recently on the 2nd of November. In that letter, I again requested a meeting with the Secretary of State and the Home Office, but I await the UK Government's response to that, as well as all other previous communication. Now, despite agreeing to meaningful engagement on migration, the UK Government has dismissed our proposals for addressing the acute labour shortage crisis, and the UK Government simply has to improve its engagement, not only with the Scottish Government, but with all devolved administrations, as well as with industry.
Claire Adamson.
Thank the Minister for her answer. As was pointed out by my colleague Jim Fairley on Channel 4, the political slot, one of Scotland's great strengths is our natural larder. But food industry leaders have been clear, Brexit has led to a critical shortage of pickers and processors. The UK Government's ad hoc visa scheme is bureaucratic, not fit to address the chaos caused by Brexit. Has the Minister had any engagement with her UK Government counterparts regarding changes to the visa scheme, which will allow us to welcome back valued food workers and build resilience into our supply chains?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I have. And to follow on from my initial response too, you know, we've really sought to engage constructively with the UK Government on so many different occasions. And the frustration is that that's been to little avail. And on the back of raising this at the last interministerial group meeting that we had in September, together with ministers from Wales and Northern Ireland, we had a follow-up meeting with Minister Victoria Prentice, where we were assured that our concerns would be looked into and that DEFRA would arrange a meeting between ourselves and the Home Office. That was 2 months ago now, and we're still waiting on a response to that. And as I said, it's just hugely frustrating that we continually pursue these matters, which are absolutely critical to our industry. And that's our food and drink industry right across the supply chain, and we're repeatedly ignored, because this is the single biggest issue that I have raised with me by food and drink businesses, again, right across the supply chain. And we need the UK Government to listen and to act to address these serious issues.
Supplementary, Liam MacArthur.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary will recall that earlier this year a seafood trade group was established within government to provide additional capacity to help seafood exporters deal with the increased bureaucracy arising from the UK's exit from the EU. Given that the issues facing seafood exporters, including Orkney Fishermen's Society, my own constituency, are likely to continue for some time, will the Cabinet Secretary commit to keeping in place this valuable additional resource?
Cabinet Secretary.
The Member's absolutely right. I think this has been a critical piece of work that we had established to deal with the issues that we're facing. And, you know, as I've just outlined, I don't think these issues are going to go away anytime soon, and they probably will be with us for some time to come. But I would just want to give them that assurance that our commitment to delivering a seafood trade strategy and all the work that's currently ongoing and the work which recognises the importance of sustainable fisheries will continue, irrespective of the internal structures that we have to deliver this. But this is, of course, something that I will consider closely and carefully.
Supplementary, Karen Mochan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Minister will be aware that an equally important issue relevant to supply chains and the food and drink industry is affordable access to sufficient amounts of nutritious food for those in our most deprived areas. Could the Minister explain why the SNP and Green MSPs failed to support the progression of a Right to Food Bill at committee stage last month and advise what action the Scottish Government is taking to address hunger and food insecurity, particularly in our rural communities?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'd be happy to provide a response to that because we do fundamentally believe in a right to food, but we've already said that the vehicle for that will be the Human Rights Bill, which will be introduced to the Parliament, because of course the right to food is an integral part of other human rights and it's only right and fair that's considered as part of that. But that's only part of the work that we're doing. At the start of October, introduced the Good Food Nation Bill to the Scottish Parliament for consideration. We have also been consulting on a draft local food strategy, and that consultation is open until the 2nd of December. Again, I would encourage everyone in here and to spread the word about that, as well as to fill in the consultation, because we want to make sure, and that's this government's intention, is to make sure that everybody living in Scotland has a right and is able to access good, healthy, local and nutritious food, and we are absolutely committed to delivering on that.
Supplementary, Beatrice Wishart.
The Northern Isles are at the end of the supply chain and rely heavily on lifeline ferry services for incoming freight. What assurances can the Scottish Government give that shortages in the national stock supply chain, impacted by Brexit and HGV driver issues, will not be the Grinch that steals islanders' Christmas?
Cabinet Secretary.
I appreciate the member's concern on that issue, but I would say that we are in regular discussion and dialogue with our retailers and right across the food and drink supply chain to ensure that that doesn't happen. And I give that commitment that this is, of course, a situation we will continue to monitor to make sure that our islands don't suffer.
Question number 4, Martin Whitfield.
Grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what actions are being taken to ensure that the agricultural sector plays a leading role in delivering a net zero Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Agriculture is absolutely taking a leading role collectively through the Agriculture Reform Implementation Oversight Board. On the 28th of October, I announced a £51 million national test programme which will support our farmers and crofters to learn how their work impacts on climate and nature and to help us understand how sustainable farming can be supported and rewarded in future. And this builds on a range of other support, including grants, advice and research, to deliver our vision for Scottish agriculture to transform the sector to become a global leader in sustainable and regenerative agriculture, delivering on our ambitious climate targets.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm grateful for that answer, and I'm sure the Minister will agree that a one-size-fits-all approach won't be effective. Our local farmers need flexibility, so what steps are the Scottish Government taking to deliver a flexible approach that will enable different farms with different circumstances to secure support to help tackle climate change?
Cabinet Secretary.
This is an absolutely critical point, and I think that that's where the work that we're undertaking through the Implementation Oversight Board is absolutely pivotal to that. We wanted to make sure that we had broad representation across the board. We have 21 members which represent all different geographies and sectors across Scotland, as well as environmental interests too. And that's so that we can really help shape and develop this policy together and to make sure that we absolutely get this right for the different parts of Scotland and the different needs that exist.
Supplementary, Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you. Last week, leading agricultural figures, including Scotland's young farmers, penned a powerful open letter of concern to Mary Goujon. Despite their efforts, hard-working farmers are being demonised over emissions and their morale is low because of a negative perception that they are to blame for climate change. And that's fuelled by some politicians. Furthermore, it didn't help that recently the First Minister, given the opportunity, did not deny that the SNP policy to meet net zero is to cull 300,000 cattle. Cabinet Secretary, Rural Scotland is waiting. Presiding Officer, I hope you will support me, and I ask that the Cabinet Secretary comes to the Chamber with a ministerial statement to address the very serious issues raised in this letter.
Cabinet Secretary.
I have to admit that I feel quite fed up of having to answer and respond to that point as well. I've done it, responded to that question 3 times from the member before in this chamber to say that to say that and reaffirm that it is not our policy to cull livestock. It hasn't been and it won't be. And I confirmed that when I was at the NFUS conference on the 28th of October and made that statement very, very clear then too. And I hope that this will finally knock that claim on the head. Now, I completely understand the concerns that have been raised by the Scottish Young Farmers. I responded to them immediately when I first received that and saw the letter that they had sent to me on Twitter, and I've since followed that up with a letter to meet with them to discuss the concerns that they have, because I absolutely am with the industry in that regard, and I'm taking every opportunity to challenge that negative perception that can exist there, because we have people that are doing fantastic pioneering work already in agriculture, and it's our job to support and encourage that and enable that through our transformation programme.
Supplementary, Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government's world-leading climate change legislation sets a target date for net zero emissions of all greenhouse gases by 2045. Could the Cabinet Secretary please outline how the recently announced National Test Programme will lay the groundwork for Scotland's agricultural sector to be global leaders in sustainable agriculture?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, because our positive vision really seeks to transform Scottish agriculture to be low carbon and sustainable in the future. And through the National Test Programme that I announced, farmers and crofters will be able to better understand their current environmental performance and efficiency, for example, through undertaking carbon audits and nutrient management plans. And that will then enable them to mitigate their businesses' greenhouse gas emissions. And the programme will also put in place livestock data and performance systems for businesses in the beef sector, with the aim of improving both business and emissions performance.
A supplementary, Willie Rennie.
Those who farm in the Fife Regional Park, the Lomond Hills, do have a significant role in the climate change efforts, but also in public access too. They don't make an awful lot of money off the land, so can the Cabinet Secretary reassure me that the new farm support mechanism will reflect the contribution that they make to climate change and also to public access, so they can continue to do the good work?
Cabinet Secretary.
Absolutely. I mean, where that good work is happening already, we want to ensure that that continues as well. And as part of the vision for agriculture that I set out, we'd already said that, you know, we want to support active farming and food production, as well as supporting our farmers and crofters to lower their emissions to the lowest possible level, as well as looking to enhance their biodiversity. And we've already said that by 2025, we'd be making half of the direct payments that we have conditional. But like I say, we very much want to support active farming and food production and to keep people on our land.
Question number 5, Emma Harper.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Rural Affairs Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues and rural businesses regarding action to improve and enhance rural skills development.
Cabinet Secretary.
I keep ministerial colleagues regularly informed, highlighting the particular issues that are faced by rural businesses, many of which are micro businesses, and that's allowed us to invest in rural skills projects and targeted support for employers. And on my visits to rural businesses across the country, skills are always one of the main topics of conversation, and these visits provide me with the opportunity to hear firsthand how employers benefit from investment in the skills of their workforce. And just last month I visited Wee Cook in Barry near Carnoustie. And that's an award-winning business which is doing fantastic work with apprentices to launch a practical toolkit for rural employers on how they can invest in apprenticeships, training and work placements.
Emma Harper.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Skills planning, which meets the current and future needs of Scotland's rural economy, is a vital part of the suite of measures needed to develop a highly skilled workforce and deliver sustainable economic growth. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline how the Skills Action Plan for Rural Scotland 2019 to 2021 is working to support rural skills across Dumfries and Galloway and the Scottish borders?
Cabinet Secretary.
The Skills Action Plan has really driven forward a partnership approach to developing the skills and talent that's needed to make sure that Scotland's rural economy and communities essentially continue to flourish as well as to grow. And people are really key to driving forward our rural communities, making them sustainable and inclusive places to live, work and thrive. And through the actions that are identified under the plan's 5 priority areas, it ensures that we have the right people with the right skills. Now, we're currently commissioning an evaluation to determine the success of the plan in achieving its objectives, while also reviewing what lessons might be learnt from the first 2 years of the plan too. And that evaluation will really help inform the direction of any future support for skills development and the coordination of that in Rural Scotland.
A supplementary, Ariane Burgess.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To support the rural skills, in addition to the national test programme that we just heard about from the Cabinet Secretary, can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, will the Scottish Government set up and invest in a land advisory service tasked with supporting the whole sector to become a global leader in regenerative agriculture through training, advisory services, research, improving supply chains, supporting cooperation, encouraging farm diversification, knowledge transfer, innovation and marketing?
Cabinet Secretary.
I hope the member will understand that I'm obviously reluctant to commit to that absolutely today, but that's because with the work that we're undertaking with the Agriculture Reform Implementation Oversight Board, we're looking at all these issues and how they can best be tackled. So I think it's, as well as developing the policies that will help with that transformation, very much working with our farmers and crofters to do that too. So I think it's really important that we consider all these issues as part of the work of the board so that we can really develop and work on that together.
Question number 6 has been withdrawn. Question number 8, Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what progress is being made on making payments to farmers and crofters through this year's National Basic Payment Support Scheme.
Cabinet Secretary.
Scottish farmers and crofters are an essential part of our rural economy, and the Scottish Government is committed to supporting farmers and crofters, and once again was the first UK paying agency to make advanced loan payments available to maintain cash flows through the recovery from coronavirus and overcome the challenges presented by Brexit. Now, we started making payments in September, injecting more than £330 million into the Scottish rural economy, and these advanced payments are worth up to 95% of their final claim value. And in contrast to that, farmers in England will need to wait until December, while farmers in Wales and Northern Ireland started to receive advance and full payments from the 15th of October. Now, the loan scheme closed on the 12th of November with full scheme payments in respect of basic payment scheme, greening and young farmer payment on track to commence from early December.
Evelyn Tweed.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the answer. Does she agree with me that initiatives such as the National Basic Payment Support Scheme are demonstrative of this SNP government's support for Scotland's agricultural sector, as opposed to the actions of the Tory government in Westminster, who have chosen to endanger Scottish agriculture by agreeing trade deals which offer little to no benefit but threaten great harm?
Cabinet Secretary.
I couldn't agree more with that, because the Scottish Government are committed to supporting and protecting our farmers and crofters, who do work extremely hard to produce quality products to world-leading standards. And it's really disappointing that the UK Government disagreed to propose amendments in
Excuse
both
me,
the UK...
Excuse me a minute, Cabinet Secretary. Could we have less chuntering from a sedentary position? The Cabinet Secretary is trying to answer the question that was asked by Evelyn Tweed. Thank you. Please resume, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I was just saying that I was disappointed that the UK Government disagreed to proposed amendments in both the UK Agriculture Act 2020 and the Trade Act 2021 that would have enshrined in domestic law that imports of agri-food have to be produced to equivalent standards to that of the UK, and therefore would have protected Scottish farmers and crofters. Now, we saw these agreements rushed through before the Trade and Agriculture Commission was fully established. There was no engagement with us, with other devolved administrations, or in fact with industry prior to reaching these agreements, and I think that's in stark contrast to the approach that I believe had taken place in both Australia and New Zealand with their own industry. And all of that is for the sake of an expected increase in GDP of 0.02% from the Australian deal, 0.0% from the New Zealand deal, and it simply beggars belief.
And I call a supplementary from Edward Mountain, who is joining us remotely. Mr. Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I refer members to my register of interest. Cabinet Secretary, given that the most inept Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs that we have ever had in Scotland, who oversaw the failure of the CAP IT system, managed to get all basic single farm payments without any deductions or loans out before the middle of November each year, why can't you?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm sorry, there were elements of that question that I think I might have missed. But, I mean, first of all, I think the comment that he's made about the previous Cabinet Secretary is an absolute disgrace, and I don't think that befits him. And we've done everything that we can to make sure that our farmers and crofters have the cash flow that they need. We've made our payments at the earliest ever stage. And that's why at the NFUS conference, again on the 28th of October, to ensure that we have that continuity and can offer that stability for our farmers and crofters, I made the announcement that the rate for basic payments won't reduce in the lifetime of the Parliament, and made the commitment that we'll endeavour to get those payments out before December each year through our national loan schemes.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions, and there'll be a very short pause before we move on to the next item of business. Thank you.